Hey guys, it's Greg with Apple Explained, and today we're taking a look at the history of Siri. Remember Siri being introduced on stage alongside the iPhone 4S? It was an incredible moment that impressed not only the audience, but also tech critics like Walt Mossberg, who called it a standout feature of the 4S. But Siri didn't evolve as quickly as most expected, and now the same people who were praising Siri back in 2011 are now asking why Siri seems so dumb. What went wrong with Siri, and how did it fall so far behind its competition? Well, the answer can be found in examining the path Siri has been on since its development back in 2005. You may not have known this, but Siri wasn't made by Apple. It was built by the SRI International Artificial Intelligence Center, and they made it available as an app on the iOS App Store in 2010. The signature voice for Siri was provided by voice actress Susan Bennett, and there were also British and Australian voices available for Siri provided by John Briggs and Karen Jacobson. After the Siri app had been live for 2 months, Apple acquired the company and integrated the voice assistant into the iPhone 4S. Apple then removed the Siri app and limited the feature to the 4S, even though the app had supported the iPhone 4. It was clear Apple used Siri as the new shiny feature to entice customers to upgrade their devices, but we know the feature could have been made available for at least the iPhone 4 since Trofton Smith, working with an anonymous partner, managed to hack Siri and enabled it to run on the iPhone 4 and iPod Touch. Apple later included Siri on the iPod Touch and iPad in 2012, the Apple TV in 2015, and the Mac in 2016. Other tech companies jumped into the AI market, with more than a half dozen Siri-like services launching in 2012 alone. Samsung debuted S-Voice, a voice-controlled assistant. Nuance, a provider of speech recognition software, released a Siri for apps called Nina. Startups Evi and Maluba each released virtual assistant apps. IBM began working on adapting Watson into a turbocharged Siri that could help physicians, farmers, Wall Street traders, and students. And Google followed Siri with its own conversational assistant, Google Now. The early versions of these voice assistants often performed worse than Siri, and this positioned Apple as a leader in the industry. But this has changed, and it was because of a difficult decision Apple made that no other company embraced. Apple decided that they would not collect data on the inquiries users made with Siri. They kept as much data on the local device as possible, and if inquiries needed to be sent to the cloud, Apple stripped the request of any reference to the user ID and assigned it a random request ID. It was then encrypted and sent up to the cloud for more voice recognition to identify the words, and for natural language processing to understand the meaning and serve an appropriate response. This is the same process Siri uses today, and it's a major reason why Apple has lost its dominance in the AI market. Apple's competitors like Google and Facebook became more creative and aggressive about leveraging user data and cloud computing to make their assistants more and more helpful. This came with the benefit of a smarter voice assistant, but turned their customers into products whose information would be sold to the highest bidder. After all, they're advertising companies, which means monetizing user data is their primary source of revenue. Apple, on the other hand, enjoys earning about 75% of their revenue from hardware and is in a much better position to pass up the opportunity to monetize their users' data. But the way these tech companies were handling user data wasn't fully understood until recently with the Cambridge Analytica incident. So from the user's point of view, Siri's progress appeared to be pretty stagnant compared to Google Now, Amazon Alexa, and Microsoft Cortana. This contributed to an opinion in the tech industry that Apple was losing its ability to innovate. Even the Wall Street Journal wrote, "Apple is playing catch-up in a product category it invented, increasing worries about whether the technology giant has lost some of its innovation edge." With this mounting pressure from customers, journalists, and competitors, Apple could have easily caved and began mining user data just like every other company, but they held strong to their belief that customer data should remain private. But this position didn't stop Apple from making improvements to Siri. A year after its introduction, iOS 6 brought several new features. It could understand and answer sports-related questions. You could simply speak to Siri and get game schedules, scores, player info, and team records. Siri supported baseball, basketball, football, soccer, and hockey, including a number of sports leagues. This is also when Siri's AI engine became really good at understanding comparison inquiries like who's taller, LeBron or Kobe, and responded with the right answer. Along with sports, Siri also gained the ability to understand movie-related questions. By tapping into Rotten Tomatoes' database, Siri could now display movie reviews and ratings. She could also supply movie listings based on location or showtime. Requesting information about a particular movie also became possible. Movie information was presented in a neat, compact card that aggregated all relevant information, including awards, cast members, ratings, and trailers. Siri also gained a number of new restaurant-specific features. You could find restaurants based on cuisine, price, location, and ratings. Integration with Yelp and OpenTable were also added so you could see reviews, ratings, and photos of restaurants within Siri, and if you liked a place, you could tell Siri to take you into the OpenTable app to make a reservation. Integration with Facebook and Twitter were also added so you could quickly post a status update with Siri, and Siri gained the ability to launch applications. A year later, iOS 7 introduced even more changes to Siri. The most noticeable improvement was the user interface. It took over the entire screen rather than sliding up from the bottom and occupying only a portion of the display. "What can I help you with?" appeared when Siri was activated, and a new waveform ran along the bottom to give users a visual cue when Siri was listening. Another major change was Apple's decision to ditch Google in favor of Bing for web searches. But you could still access Google with Siri by saying "search Google" before an inquiry. A common problem for Siri at the time was its struggle with requests for trivial information, an area where its competition began to excel. Apple tried to remedy this by integrating Wikipedia with Siri, but it was a clumsy solution since it only worked with general inquiries, and the users had to search for information themselves on the Wikipedia page instead of Siri providing a specific answer. iOS 7 also gave Siri the ability to adjust certain system settings like airplane mode, Bluetooth, screen brightness, and do not disturb mode. Apple also introduced a male voice for Siri and made the female voice more clear and natural. The following year, iOS 8 introduced the popular "Hey Siri" voice command so you could summon Siri hands-free. It was also integrated with Shazam so you could identify a song without opening the Shazam app by asking Siri, "What's this song?" Another interesting capability was purchasing iTunes content with Siri. In iOS 9, contextual awareness was the biggest update made. If you asked Siri to remind you to do something while looking at a message you've received, Siri would understand what you meant and add the event. Siri also became more aware of location, so a very specific reminder like "call mom when I get in the car" was possible. Siri Smarts was brought to the search window with Siri Suggestions, which included a list of people you speak with often, apps you might want to use depending on the time of day, nearby venues like restaurants and gas stations, and relevant news. With the announcement of iOS 10 in 2016, Apple opened up third-party developer access to Siri with a dedicated API that restricted usage of Siri to engaging with third-party messaging apps, payment apps, ride-sharing apps, and internet calling apps. In iOS 11, Apple gave Siri improved male and female voices that were designed to more closely mimic natural human speech. Apple said Siri's new voice options were powered by deep learning for better pronunciation and a more expressive voice. Siri also got a new user interface and could translate phrases from English to Chinese, French, German, Italian, and Spanish, with more languages to come. Siri also began using on-device learning to understand more about your preferences and interests to better anticipate what you might want next, and it would sync that information across all your Apple devices so the Siri experience was the same regardless of what product you were using. Despite these consistent updates Siri has received over the years, it's still lagging behind the competition today and has lots of room for improvement. Norman Winarski, one of the creators of Siri, recently spoke about its current state, how far the personal assistant has come, and how much different it is now than what they originally envisioned. According to Winarski, Siri was originally meant to be a virtual travel and entertainment concierge. The idea was if you needed something done related to these areas, Siri would take care of it for you. So if you showed up at the airport and your flight was delayed, then Siri would automatically work on finding you a different flight. And if that didn't work, Siri would find you a nearby hotel room to try and accommodate your needs. Winarski said, "Were you to arrive at an airport to discover a canceled flight, for example, Siri would already be searching for an alternate route home by the time you pulled your phone from your pocket, and if none was available, would have a hotel room ready to book. It would have a smaller remit, but it would learn it flawlessly and then gradually extend to related areas." Apple launched Siri as an assistant that can help you in all areas of your life, a bigger challenge that will inevitably take longer to perfect. Today, Siri is something that goes beyond travel and entertainment, and it's easy to say that the development process that Winarski had originally envisioned to make Siri work perfectly in a couple areas first and then expand from there is not something Apple is really following. Siri tries to do a lot of things, some of those things it can do well enough and others not so much. Winarski says that Apple's efforts are exceptionally hard as the company has to deal with a lot of customers out in the real world. but adds that Apple may be working for a level of perfection they can't get. But I should mention that based on its latest tests, Siri was capable of recognizing 95% of a user's speech, putting it on par with Amazon Alexa and Microsoft Cortana. The issues arise when considering how Siri responds to our inquiries. Sometimes it doesn't give us quite the information we were looking for, and this is the area where Siri's shortcomings are revealed. Greg Joswiak, Apple's Vice President of iPod, iPhone, and iOS Product Marketing, said, "From the beginning, Apple wanted Siri to be a get-stuff-done machine. It drives me crazy that people compare virtual assistants by asking trivia questions, which always makes Siri look bad. We didn't engineer this thing to be Trivial Pursuit. So not like Trivial Pursuit, and more like a digital personal assistant meant to help users get something done. Which, all things considered, Siri does accomplish fairly reliably. But what do you think? How often do you use Siri, and how reliable is it for you? Some friends of mine never use it, while others push its capabilities to the limit. I typically only use Siri for making calls, sending quick texts, and setting timers. Let me know how Siri has been working for you, and if you enjoyed the video, don't forget to leave a like. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time."